ओम ज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानञ्जनशलाखया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांता स्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
So here, the Lord is describing about how Jaya and Vijaya, his personal servant, would return very soon from the material world. This departure was already foretold from the Vaikuntha planet to the material world by Mother Lakshmi, because she had become angry when she was stopped, when she had left the abode of the Lord, and when she returned and the Lord was sleeping. So Jaya and Vijaya had forbidden her to come. So this departure from Vaikuntha was already foretold by Mother Lakshmi. So it was the desire of the Supreme Lord and Mother Lakshmi. And the next verse, the Lord is describing that even though Jaya and Vijaya, they will become demons, they will become asuras, still they will have the blessings that they will be able to practice Bhakti Yoga in unfavorable rasa. There are five primary rasas and then there are many secondary rasas. Secondary rasas are indirect, primary rasas are direct. So, they will be able to practice Bhakti Yoga in anger. So that's what the Lord is saying. Mai samrambha yogena. So Prabhupada translates, by practice of mystic yoga in anger. So what will happen if they practice thinking of the Lord in anger, thinking of the Lord unfavorably as enemy? So the result will be nistirya brahma helanam. They will become free from the curse of the Brahman. Brahmanas had given them the curse that they have become sinful and now they should go to the material world, because until and unless the living entities are sinful, they don't take birth in the material world. At least as devotees, they don't take birth. They will be born as materialistic people or asura. The devotees of the Lord also come, but they come by the arrangements of the Lord. The living entities, other living entities, they come to the material world because of their karma. And karma is because of sinful activities we perform in this material world. So they will become free from these sinful activities just by thinking of the Lord in anger. Then, pratyeshayatam nikasham me kalena alpiyasa punaha. So once they are freed from these sinful reactions, then very soon they will be able to come back in due course of time. So Prabhupada is very nicely explaining in the purport, first from the commentary by Madhvacharya. So Madhvacharya explains that it's very difficult to come out of the sins of Brahma Shapa. If somebody is cursed by a Brahmana, if somebody is cursed by a Vaishnava, then actually it is impractical, it is almost impossible to come out of that curse. But he says, by practicing Bhakti Yoga, one can become free from all sinful reactions. But Bhakti Yoga is so potent, it is so powerful that all sinful reaction can be wiped away by practicing Bhakti Yoga. Even a Brahma Shapa or a curse by Brahmana, which cannot be overcome by any other means, can be overcome by Bhakti Yoga. So one can imagine the potency of Bhakti Yoga. Of course, one should not understand it in a wrong way. This does not give a license to us to commit offenses against Brahmanas or against Vaishnavas, thinking anyway Madhvacharya is saying, scriptures are saying, Bhakti Yoga is very potent. If I practice Bhakti Yoga, we will become free from even Brahmana, you know, Shapa. So we will become free from those. But actually, that is incidental. If it is accidental, it happens, one can become free. But if one becomes offensive to the Vaishnavas or to the Brahmanas, then that is a very, very severe offense. And until and unless the devotee himself pardons, even the Supreme Lord doesn't pardon the offenses done to the Vaishnavas. So it should not be wrongly understood that Bhakti Yoga practicing gives me a license that I can commit offenses to the devotees, and then Bhakti Yoga is very potent and it can wipe away all kind of sinful reactions. So we should not misunderstand that. Next, Prabhupada explains that actually the most important theme of Krishna consciousness is to always remember the Lord, always think of the Lord. In Bhagavad Gita also Krishna says, man mana bhava mad bhakto, right? And Rupa Goswami also explains, yena kena prakarena manaha Krishna navasye. Somehow or other, the most important thing is to keep your mind fixed on Krishna. So to think of Krishna, that is the background, most important basic principle of Krishna consciousness. Some volume can be reduced little, some humming is there. So that is the most important background of Krishna consciousness. It is the basic principle of Krishna consciousness. We all understand that how in Bhagavad Gita and in Bhagavatam, this principle is very nicely elaborated. In Bhagavatam, it is explained that even if one thinks of the Lord, even with lusty desire, kamam, or if one thinks of the Lord in anger, krodham, or one thinks of the Lord in bhayam, in anxiety and in fear, still one will become liberated from this world. All his sinful reactions will be finished, vanquished, and he will become liberated from this world. Just like Bhagavatam, the example is given that many of the gopis were actually attracted to the Supreme Lord in lustful desire, kamam. So they were attracted to the Lord that he is a beautiful young boy. And just by thinking even in that direction, they became purified. Similarly, we find the example in Bhagavatam about Kamsa or Shishupala. How they were always thinking in fear, in anger, they were always thinking of Krishna. Because they were always thinking that Krishna is going to the cause of their death. So very, very fearfully, even in their sleep, every moment, he was not free of thinking of Krishna. So that is also Krishna consciousness. Consciousness of Krishna is called Krishna consciousness. But here we have to distinguish, favorably they were not disposed, they were unfavorably disposed. So they were disposed in indirect rasa, not in direct primary rasa. So Prabhupada explains in this purport that actually there are two understanding. One is direct primary rasa, and then there are indirect rasas. So even in indirect rasa, if one thinks of Krishna unfavorably also, that is also Krishna consciousness, and one will become purified from this material world. He will become purified of all his sinful reaction, including Brahma Shapa. So that is what the Lord is telling to his doorkeepers. Do not worry, you will be able to practice Bhakti Yoga in unfavorable rasa of anger, in enmity towards me, and just by thinking of me like this, you will become purified. You will become purified of Brahma Shapa, you will become purified of your sinful reactions. So then the question may arise that if we can become purified even by thinking of Krishna in unfavorable rasa, in anger, in fear, then, you know, why we have to chant the holy name of the Lord, try to remember Krishna? It is so difficult to think of Krishna by chanting the holy name, isn't it? To complete our 16 round itself is so difficult. So why not we adopt this method, unfavorable rasa, just like Kamsa was doing, isn't it? So actually, the example here Prabhupada is giving is very important to understand that act. Just try to understand, if an enemy of the Lord who is thinking of the Lord in anger or in fear, in enviousness of the Lord, if he becomes purified just by thinking about the Lord, even in anger, how much more a devotee becomes benefited by thinking of Krishna in loving relationship. If in anger itself one thinks of the Lord and he can become purified of all sinful reactions, how much more a devotee becomes benefited by thinking of the Lord favorably. This one should understand. By thinking of the Lord in anger, in this unfavorable rasas, one can become liberated from the world. One can become liberated from this material life. He can become purified of sinful reactions. But still there is no guarantee that he will become a devotee of the Lord. That is what one should understand. Rather, the devotee actually understands the importance of practicing Bhakti Yoga by understanding this. He thinks, what is the use of so many austerities? What is the use of taking the path of Jnana Yoga, or mystic yoga, because the destination which is achieved by Jnana Yogi or Dhyana Yogi, it can be achieved even by an enemy of the Lord. The destination which is achieved by Jnana Yogi or Dhyana Yogi, that can be achieved even by the enemy of the Lord. So what is the use of practicing Jnana Yoga or mystic yoga? Because even if one does not practice Jnana Yoga or mystic yoga by reading all the Vedas, all those things, just by becoming the enemy of the Lord, thinking of the Lord in inimical way, in anger, in fear, one can get that kind of mukti. So then what is the use of performing so many penances, austerities in Jnana Yoga or Dhyana Yoga? So the devotee actually understands the importance of practicing Bhakti Yoga. That is what one should understand. By thinking of the Lord in anger, it is not that one becomes a great devotee of the Lord. He becomes freed from material life. He becomes freed from sinful reaction. But that does not guarantee one devotional service to the Lord. Because even Mayavadis also become free from this materialistic life. They also become liberated from this material world. There is a very nice conversation between Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya, which explains the importance of practicing Bhakti Yoga. So there, this is made very, very crystal clear why one should practice Bhakti Yoga and not practice either Jnana Yoga or Dhyana Yoga or being inimical towards the Lord. So that conversation is very, very interesting conversation. After Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya was convinced by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in personal understanding of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, when the Lord spoke to him on Vedanta Sutra, commentary of Bhagavatam, natural commentary of Bhagavatam on Vedanta Sutra, then Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya was fully convinced about devotional service of the Lord. So he became a great devotee of the Lord. And he was always repenting about his being a Mayavadi earlier. So much so that he would hate about the understanding of Mayavadi. So one day, after he finished his daily dincharya, he went to Jagannath temple along with Jagadananda Pandit and Damodar Pandit. And he brought huge prasadam from Jagannath temple. And then he gave that to Jagadananda Pandit and told him that kindly deliver this to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And along with that, on a palm leaf, he wrote two verses about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So those two verses were delivered to Jagadananda Pandit. And when Jagadananda Pandit went to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, before he could enter, he met Mukunda Datta. So Mukunda Datta saw these verses and he immediately wrote down at some place, he noted these two verses down and then gave that to Jagadananda Pandit to deliver it to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, because he knew that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would never allow his own praise. So when finally Jagadananda Pandit gave those two verses to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu read them, he immediately tore them into pieces and threw them away. But somehow, because Mukunda Datta had already written that down, so devotees, they all memorized those shlokas. And by His grace, we were able to have these two verses written by Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya. They are considered to be very, very valuable jewels in devotional service. So he wrote two verses about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Very famous verse, one of them. Vairagya Vidya Nija Bhakti Yoga Shikshartham Ekaha Purushaha Puranaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Sharira Dhari Krupam Budhir Yastam Aham Prapadhye. Let me take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Shri Krishna, who has descended in the form of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to teach us real knowledge, His devotional service and detachment. See, very beautifully he describes Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He is Krishna Himself. He has descended for three very important purposes: to teach us real knowledge, Shikshartham Ekaha Purushaha Puranaha. For what? Vairagya, Vairagya Vidya Nija Bhakti Yogam. To teach us real knowledge, His devotional service and detachment from whatever does not foster Krishna consciousness. He has descended because He is the ocean of transcendental mercy, Krupam Budhir. Let me surrender unto His lotus feet. Yastam Aham Prapadhye. So this was one of the verses he wrote. Another verse was, Kalan Nashtam Bhakti Yogam Nijam Yaha Pradushkartum Krishna Chaitanya Nama Avirbhutastasya Padar Vinde Gadham Gadham Liyatam Chitta Bhrangaha. Let my consciousness, which is like a honeybee, take shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who has just now appeared as Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to teach the ancient system of devotional service to Himself. This system had almost been lost due to the influence of time. So just like we see Krishna, you know, comes once again and re-establishes the parampara once again through Arjuna by speaking Bhagavad Gita, similarly, this system over a period of time, this Bhakti Yoga was lost, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu once again came to re-establish. So that is what Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya said. So after delivering this, and Jagadananda Pandit, you know, when he delivered this, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tore this and threw that out. Later on, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came back and Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya met Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya, he quoted one verse from Bhagavatam. So this is a prayer of Brahma. So the prayer is, Tatte anukampasu samikshamano bhunjan evatam kritam vipakam hridvag vapurbhir vidadham namaste jivetayo bhakti pade sadayabham. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard this, but then he saw that actually Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya has removed one word and he has replaced that word. The actual word was Mukti Pade. And now Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya has replaced it by the word Bhakti Pade. So he asked him that this is not the original verse. The original verse says Mukti Pade and you have made Bhakti Pade. What do you mean by this? So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did not approve that. So then Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya explains very nicely. That is very beautiful. He says, the awakening of pure love of Godhead, which is the result of devotional service, far surpasses liberation from material bondage. So he explains there are two things. One is liberation, which is called mukti. So one becomes liberated from this material world and attains liberation from this world. Another is when one practices devotional service to the Lord, it is not that he becomes liberated from this material world, he attains Krishna Prema, awakening of pure love of Godhead, which is the result of devotional service. It far surpasses liberation. So he says. And then he says, for those averse to devotional service, merging into Brahman effulgence is a kind of punishment. So he says this mukti is actually a punishment. Why a devotee thinks mukti is a punishment? This liberation which is so much wanted by the impersonalist. Why a devotee thinks it is a punishment? Why a devotee thinks that actually these Mayavadis are punished like this? They are all thinking we are very happy, Brahmanandi we have become. But devotees are thinking actually they are being punished. Why it is a punishment? Because actually they lose opportunity to serve the Lord. No opportunity to serve the Lord in this kind of mukti. What these impersonalists aspire for, that mukti is never aspired by the devotees. Why? There is no opportunity to serve the Lord. Rather, devotee thinks it is better to be in a hell. Because even in hell there is a possibility of serving the Lord. Even in hell there is a possibility of serving the Lord. But in this kind of mukti there is no possibility of serving the Lord. So it is more hellish than hell. Kevalyam narkayate. That is what a devotee thinks. It is more even worse than hell. See. So there Prabhupada explains very nicely about different kinds of muktis. So in Brahmanda Purana, it is said, Siddha lokastu tamasaha pare yatra vasanti hi siddha brahma sukhe magna detyascha harina hataha. You see, this is very interesting. It is given in Brahmanda Purana. In this Brahma Jyoti, two kinds of living entities exist. Two kinds of living entities get liberation in Brahma Jyoti. One is Siddha Brahma Sukhe Magna and another is Detyascha Harina Hataha. Those demons which are killed by the Lord personally, they also merge into Brahma Jyoti. And another is those who are Siddhas and who wanted Brahma Sukha, they also merge into Brahma Jyoti. So, in Siddha Loka, there are two kinds of living entities. Those who are killed by Supreme Personality of Godhead due to their having been demons in their previous life, and those who are very fond of enjoying impersonal effulgence of the Lord. So, now we can very clearly see what exactly happens to the impersonalist. The destination of the impersonalist and the destination of demons killed by the Lord when they are thinking about the Lord in anger or in inimical ways, their destination is the same, and that is never aspired by devotees. Why? Because actually there is no chance of serving the Supreme Lord. Next, further, very beautifully, he describes. Bhattacharya continued, impersonalists who do not accept the transcendental form of the Lord, and demons who are engaged in blaspheming and fighting with him, are punished by being merged into Brahman effulgence. Actually, they are punished by being pushed into Brahman effulgence, and that is also temporary, not that eternally they will remain. They will not eternally remain in Brahma Jyoti. Again, they will come back to this material world. But that does not happen to the person engaged in devotional service of the Lord. Very clear distinction. Those who are engaged in devotional service, they don't get this kind of mukti. Then further he explained, other muktis, okay. At least they give a chance to serve the Lord. Salokya, Samipya. Sometimes the devotee may accept them, but actually pure devotee doesn't accept even them. Pure devotee is saying, I don't want any mukti. Let me be born life after life, no problem. Only thing I want is your devotional service. See, this is pure devotional service. Those who may not be very pure like that, they may want some kind of this kind of mukti, like Samipya, Salokya, never Sayujya mukti, not merging in the Supreme Lord. You see, so that is also very, very important to distinguish what is actually pure devotional service of the Lord. So he says further, if there is a chance to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead, pure devotee sometimes accepts Salokya, Sarupya, Samipya or Shrasti, but never Sayujya. He never accepts this merging in the Supreme Lord. And then further he explained, pure devotee does not even like to hear about Sayujya Mukti, which inspires him with fear and hatred. He becomes very fearful. Why? Because if he gets merged into Brahma Jyoti, he will never get chance to serve the Lord. He'll not get chance. So he becomes very fearful of this mukti. He says, I'll never want this mukti. And he becomes filled with hatred towards this mukti. Indeed, the pure devotee would rather go to hell than merge into the effulgence of the Lord. He will say, my dear Lord, better you send me to hell. If you give me a choice, should I merge into Brahma Jyoti or should I go to hell? So the pure devotee will say, better, my dear Lord, you send me to hell, so that at least I will get a chance to serve you there. But I don't want this so-called Sayujya Mukti. And then he continued, there are two kinds of Sayujya Mukti. See, this is very interesting. Because sometimes we think, at least yogis are better. They are worshipping Paramatma. They are worshipping the form of the Lord. It's a fact. They are better than the jnanis who are only worshipping the impersonal form of the Lord. But even these yogis, if they don't become devotees of the Lord, they are also condemned. Why? Even though they began with understanding of the form of the Lord, they want to merge in the form of the Lord. So there are two kinds of Sayujya Mukti. Jnanis want to merge in impersonal Brahman. Yogis want to merge in body of the Lord. So this is Bhattacharya is explaining, there are two kinds of Sayujya Mukti. There are two kinds of Sayujya Mukti. Merging into Brahman effulgence, merging into personal body of the Lord. And he says, merging into the Lord's body is even more abominable than merging into his effulgence. Why? Because they had a better chance They had a chance to accept the form of the Lord, but even after knowing that He is having a form, they don't want to serve His form, they want to become one with His form. So even that is more dangerous, that is far more abominable, He says. So this is, that means actually this is the destination of the jnanis and the yogis. Then further he says, he concludes, Sarvam Bhattacharya concluded, even though he is offered all kinds of liberation, the pure devotee does not accept them. He is fully satisfied engaging in the service of the Lord. So that's why he is saying, my dear Lord, this world, Mukti Pade, after I have become a devotee, I don't like this word Mukti at all. Because the moment I hear of this word Mukti, I can only understand this kind of Mukti. So then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually explains the real meaning of Mukti Pade. So he says, this Mukti Pade does not refer to Sayujya Mukti. Don't misunderstand that this refers to Sayujya Mukti. Mukti Pade refers to the Supreme Lord, one who awards, one whose lotus feet awards all kinds of liberation. That Mukunda is called Mukti Pade. Another name of the Lord is Mukunda or Mukti Pade. You see. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explains that actually that refers to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu replied, the word Mukti Pade has another meaning. Mukti Pade directly refers to Supreme Personality of Godhead. All kinds of liberation exist under the feet of Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, he is known as Mukti Pade. According to another meaning, Mukti is the ninth subject and the Supreme Personality is the shelter of liberation. So we all know that there are 10 subject matters described in Bhagavatam. Mukti is the ninth, liberation is the ninth. And all other, including Mukti, are at the shelter of the lotus feet of Krishna. Krishna is called Ashraya. All other are Ashrita, dependent on the Supreme Lord. So, and that is another meaning of Mukti Pade, why it's called as Mukti Pade. Then Sarvabhauma, he replies, although your explanation is correct, it should not be used because there is an ambiguity in the word Mukti Pade. The word Mukti refers to 5 kind of liberation, but its direct meaning usually conveys the idea of becoming one with the Lord. Generally, when one reads, they all think Mukti Pade means we have to become one with the Lord. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, even though he explained everything, but when he understood this, he became very ecstatic. The very sound of the word Mukti immediately induces hate and fear. But when we say Bhakti, we naturally feel transcendental bliss within the mind. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw so much transformation in Bhattacharya, that, you know, he is even hating the word Mukti, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu immediately embraced him. You see? Upon hearing this explanation, the Lord began to laugh and with great pleasure immediately embraced Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya very firmly. Of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explained the real meaning, that actually it is Krishna. It is not Sayujya Mukti it is referring to. But seeing the transformation in Bhattacharya, who was mad after impersonalism, and now he has become such a great devotee that he doesn't want to even hear the word Mukti also. You see. So, one can understand actually that even the demons who are, you know, in anger or in fear or in unfavorable rasa thinks of the Lord, even they become liberated from this material world. What is so great about becoming, being freed from sinful reactions and becoming liberated from this material world? The destination of pure devotional service is different. The destination of the pure devotee is that they are able to attain the highest goal of human form of life, the highest goal of this very existence, prema pumartho mahan, is able to attain the loving devotional service, the Krishna prema. So we'll stop with this. Grantha Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.